So our brake pedal isn't fully developed and we're, till we're 22 to 26-ish, yeah.
Did you say that females, their frontal lobe is fully developed sooner?
Yeah, sooner, no, sooner, sooner than males typically. I mean, that's, I just sort of threw that out as it's.
Well, no, that's interesting, that's good. Does that have something to do with the hormones then?
Oh, it's a good question, I don't know that exactly. Yeah, I don't know that. And you know, I should probably caveat that, it's, yeah. And it's an average, right? So it's, there's lots of exceptions in there, yeah. Yes? Yes, you have to ask a question now.
I just wanted to make a statement, what I tell my friends and my family, because I suffer from severe depression and anxiety. The description is, it's dark, it's heavy, it's mean and ugly, and it doesn't discriminate.
Yeah.
And the stigma is still there because they don't understand, they just cannot understand my why it, you know, they can see it in my eyes that my bad days, you can tell. I mean, I don't take care of myself, I don't eat, or I don't, it's there, so it's there. And it's hard, to accept it and to learn to live with it. Because there isn't, you can't fix it, there's no fixing it to able to deal with it and live with it. And acceptance is a virtue.
Yeah, so thank you for sharing that. Yeah, for all of you guys, the system, yeah, exactly. Hey, we should probably turn it over too for individual, is there somebody that wants to kind of come up and share some or not? Just know that if you want to, start coming up. In the meantime, let's just keep answering questions or trying to answer questions, yeah.
Can nutrition play a part?
Oh, yes, yeah. So again, think about yourself as a machine, right? So that, you know, your machine needs healthy raw materials to operate, right? And especially if that bacterial milieu has a lot to do with our emotions, right? So we eat a lot of processed food in America. And we're finding out, right, that maybe that's not such a good idea, that we should spend more time at the farmer's market and go through all the work of making our food, right?
Can you talk about the difference between bipolar 1 and 2?
Absolutely, thank you. So, to diagnose bipolar 1 versus bipolar 2, by default, every mood disorder becomes bipolar 1 when there is a defined manic episode. If there's no manic episode, right, then it becomes bipolar 2. So we diagnose a mood disorder. In a sense, what you can think of as a decision-making tree. We're going to diagnose a mood disorder first, and then we got to figure out, is it one or two? If there's ever been symptoms that would equate to a manic episode, even if it happened 10 years ago, it becomes a bipolar 1 disorder. And it's bipolar 1 then for the rest of your life. If there's never been a manic episode, then it's a bipolar 2 disorder. And if a manic episode happens in the future, then it becomes bipolar 1. Right? Yeah. If you did not have manic or hypomanic, but just had depression, right, then it would either be a major depressive disorder or a pervasive depressive disorder. One of those two, remember? Major depression was on the far right, and yeah.
You just said bipolar 2 was no manic episode.
No manic episode, but still a hypomanic episode. You gotta have a hypomanic episode for it to be bipolar.
Shorter,
less intense,
less
intense. Less intense.
Don't all medications that are prescribed for all of these have side effects?
Yes, every medication has a side effect. Yeah.
I can imagine that it would be really difficult to diagnose adolescents when you look at a lot of these, because I know I rationalize as a parent, is it just teenager? Is it
before a correct diagnosis is given, if you will. And part of the reason for that is sometimes, especially early on, ADHD and a bipolar diagnosis can look in a teenager like almost the same thing, right, as it's sort of emerging. Right?
So what age do you recommend that an adolescent be tested or sat down and
So what I would recommend really would be to take the word age out, right, and to say, anytime you have a teenager who is really struggling, right, it's time to think about asking the question, why are you struggling? Do we need to go to the educational arena to kind of ask that question? If the symptoms are really just showing up at school or just about schoolwork, then that would be a place to start, right? But if you see some of these symptoms at home or socially, right, then it's time to say, all right, we need to go talk to the primary care physician or a psychologist about kind of figuring some of this stuff out. And then even when you go see a psychologist, it may take a while for this to kind of emerge enough that we know what's going on. Yeah. But, you know, it's interesting because you know, in adolescence, for example, one of the ways that we distinguish or try to distinguish the difference between attention deficit and a mood disorder is that a mood disorder tends to be, the symptoms tend to be more pervasive. Right? Attention deficit, the symptoms like attention, for example, is going to be there with attention deficit both at school and at home and in all the environments of the child's life. Somebody with a mood disorder may have attention that doesn't work very well for a period of time, but then they have a period of time maybe where they aren't attending. Right? So we start to try to differentiate some of that stuff. Right? Somebody with ADHD may talk fast, and an adolescent with a mood disorder may talk fast. Right? One of the hallmarks, a little bit, is actual sort of libido or sexual energy. We tend to see that more in a mood disorder and not so much with ADHD. It tends to be atypical with ADHD. So we have to kind of ferret some of these things out, and that's always not always easy to do. Yeah. Adolescents don't always like to talk about libido, except with their friends.
Yeah. Would that be the same then, pretty much in adults? You know, you're just talking about the sexual energy.
So an adult with ADHD and an adult with a mood disorder, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
So, what is the feeling on the shock treatments for depression?
Mm-hmm. Wonderful, from my perspective. Right? From the person who has to get the shock treatment, scary. Right? But ECT treatment is actually very effective, especially when medications have not done well. And ECT treatment is very different today than it was 15 or 20 years ago. Right? So one of the, for example, typically speaking, what I know of it, I don't know a whole lot, I'm not an expert certainly, but one of the differences is with ECT treatment these days, we tend to just do ECT treatment on one side of the brain and not on both. Right. In the past, we used to do bilateral ECT treatment. We also do the shock therapy part of it. It's of a much shorter duration and more targeted to specific parts of the brain. Right. It's hard to target it because it does generalize in the brain, but it's much more shorter duration, right, than what we used to do in the past. So side effects like memory loss can still happen. But don't happen near as much and tend not to be nearly as intense as they were in the past.
I had the shock treatments in the 60s.
Did you?
And 10, and I had 5 shock treatments in 10 days.
Uh-huh.
Whoa. It was scary.
Yeah, it is.
But I haven't ever had, that I know of, I haven't gone crazy again.
Anybody else say this, but one thing that I would say, just based on my observations of people I've worked with that have had ECT, a little bit is kind of like a reset button, and it can be very effective. Not always, there's a new procedure called transcranial magnetic stimulation. That's now available in Grand Rapids. It's sort of the same principles, but it uses a targeted magnetic wave and not an electric shock. And the cool thing about transcranial magnetic stimulation is it really does seem to be effective for depression, but it's also showing a lot of effectiveness with anxiety. That's somebody's knockoff. I want to make a lot of money. I don't know. I shouldn't say that so quickly. It's transcranial magnetic stimulation is, I mean, it almost looks like you're going a little bit into a CAT scan, kind of. It's got this big thing, and it looks like this big tube pointed at you. Yeah, it's a huge medical device. It costs a lot of money. Now, having kind of said my inappropriate smart aleck remark, let me say that there is often devices you can buy that do biofeedback, right? Relaxation. Those can be really helpful, right? Especially if you're teaching yourself how to relax. Skin temperature actually has a lot to do with stress. And so we can buy devices that help us learn how to raise our skin temperature a little bit. And for a lot of reasons that we're not going to go into tonight, that means you're having less adrenaline flow into your body, which means you're more relaxed.
So you would lower your skin?
Raise your skin.
To be calm.
Right? Yeah, stressed people have colder skin.
You need more stimulation than you need.
This is what exercise.
And for a lot of other reasons, that's
exactly
what
I wanted to ask about.
All right, I've got a question over here, and then we'll come back.
I was wondering if you have seen if you have any patients that use a Fisher-Wallace device, and if you've seen long